or sorry, the top left, you'll see that there's a drop down here for the classes, so you can select what semester you want, if you want your all, if you want to select your current classes for this year. If once you're on PowerSchool for a little while, you'll be able to go back and select the previous years. So this is your classes. These are all the classes that I'm teaching this year. They're available in my drop down. Okay. I'll select my semester too. Below, we have categories. Here we have four predefined categories that come with gradebook. These categories you can rename right now, or if you want, you can add, and I'll show you in a minute how you can add some categories. At the top here, when you first open gradebook, it will default to the score sheet, which is what you see here. We have assignments tab, which is another way that you can enter assignments. Student info. Grade setup, which is done by the office. So the teachers, any of the dates here cannot be changed by the teachers. It's done through the office. And some reports. Back to the score sheet. And under the reporting term here is a drop down of my reporting terms that I have set up in my school. So currently right now I would be in T3. This is where I would set up my T3 assignments. Again, this would be my T4 assignments. Okay. If I want to see all the assignments that I've set up for the whole year, I would say all. Okay, what I'm going to do now is create a new category. I'm going to go down here to the left-hand corner, select Add, and if I want to create a category called Lab, an abbreviation, give it a color, I'm going to keep everything else the same. Okay, you can see that now my Lab category appears on the bottom left. Now to create assignment within that lab, I can go into my reporting period 3 or 4, whatever we currently are in. I can select, I can go into my assignment tab or back into my score sheet. The plus to create an assignment. The assignment pane opens up and I'll call this, not very creative, lab 1. Abbreviation, it automatically, when you tab or mouse, it will fill in the abbreviation. The category I just selected was lab. I can now select it in my drop down because this is my category that I'm working with. The date due, I have to make sure the date due is within the time period of my terms above. So I'm going to keep it at today's date and save. Now you can see that my lab assignment has been added. And now I can add marks. Oops. Okay, one more thing that I'll briefly go over is the individual student report. This is the report that you will be using to send to School Zone. It's under the Reports tab. I select Individual Student Report. I select a little arrow. The report interface comes up. It defaults to PDF. I'm currently on my Science 14 class, so it's on the selected class. I can select a date range. I can select a start and end date if I wish. Run report. I can open my report to view it. Okay, so now I have 32 individual student reports that I can send up to School Zone. Okay. So that's the individual student report. Back to the score sheet. I just want to mention again that these terms, these dates here are what are set up in the office and the teachers cannot, so whatever the administration decides on for the dates for your T1 to T3, 4, These are going to be set up in the office of the teacher. This is the only thing that the teacher cannot change. Any questions? Pretty quick? Yes?
Sorry, I've got a question. If you go back to the grade book, you know when you inputted the raw scores?
Yes.
I'm going to use the very inappropriate word of cis, but
okay.
They used to have, when you put the raw score, it has the percentage next to it.
Okay.
The problem that we're having with our staff is they're so used to having that percentage, now they have to go and figure, because if it's not out of 5, or if it's not out of 10, if it's out of 23 or something,
okay.
They're trying to figure out those percentages there.
Okay, and I'll just show you, you can put it in through points, you can put it in through percentage, I put it in through percentage of 100.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Anthony's going to get into a little bit more about
how
that works. Okay, yes?
What about letter grades?
Absolutely. I'm working in high school right now, your school is defaulted to depend on what your school is. If you're in elementary school, all your classes will be defaulted to letter grades, okay? If you're in elementary junior high, your elementary will be defaulted to letter grades, and your senior high or your junior high would be defaulted to percentages. And then if you want certain subjects for letter grades, we can do that. You can put letter grades in here. Absolutely no problem. The way you can do it, grade.
Will the report print that way?
Yes, as long as it's set up correctly in the office.
When you say we're in elementary junior high, when you say our junior high is defaulted to percentages,
right.
Is that something we can change as a school so that when the teachers get it, it's defaulted to?
Right. If your elementary would be letter grades, your junior high, you want a mixture or straight letter grades?
Straight letter grades.
Okay, yeah, that would be done, I believe, at the district level. But if you need to do individual sections, like if you want your core to be percentage and your options to be letter grade, that would be done at the office level.
When you say it's done at the district level, is there some ivory tower that happens in?
Yes. It's my office. Some of you may or may not know, but the courses are set up at the district level, elementary, junior high, and of course senior high courses are all, the course codes are defined by Alberta Education. We have defaulted the grade scale for elementary courses to be letter grade, and for grades 7 to 12 courses, they are all defaulted to a numeric grade scale. If you want to use something different, if all of your classes at junior high you want to default it to letter grade, you can do that on each individual class, and in some cases, depending on our workload, our programmers have been able to go in and just mass default for you. But it's something that you can do at the school level.
Course by course,
yeah.
Teacher by teacher.
Class by class.
With those letter grades, can we adjust the parameters of what an A is, what a B is, what a...
Those are set at the
district.
Those guys over in the corner over there, those assessment guys.
Oh, yeah. I thought as much.
So, yeah, and when Anthony starts, you'll get a sort of a broader picture of how this all works.
Okay?
That's a good question.
Wait, so the fun thing about one like this is now I'm going to break because I'm going to move things around because I kind of talk differently than at desk because people know me, know I'm ADHD, and I can't sit still that long. So I need to kind of reconfigure so you can talk amongst yourself, get coffee, sign in, do a dance, sing a song. Okay, so good morning. My name's Anthony Walsh, and I'm here to talk about some things about grade book. I'm not a trainer. I have nothing to do with Pearson. I'm not digital technology or ITS. I reside in a nebulous place called Research Data and Knowledge, where I am in several parts these days. When you picked up your sheets, there was 3 of them. This one's kind of like at the end, you'll see its purpose at the very end. It just kind of summarizes a lot of things. This is also for the end, or as you're going along, and what this is next year, as a schools, you may want things to happen. And if you can think of any as you're going along, it'd be appreciated if these are written down for those that'll be putting it in next year. And this one is simply for notes. As you're going along and things come to your eye, you come to your mind, you can jot down some notes or ideas you might have, and you can use those as you see fit. So my name's Anthony Walsh. Give you an idea of who I am and how I ended up here in front of you today. Some of you have heard this several times and can probably actually do this better than me, because I forget from time to time because I'm not that smart. I've been in a couple districts now, and I've been in elementary junior high, I've been in junior high, and I've been in senior high, and I've been in junior senior high, and I've been in cyber school, and a couple departments downtown. And I traded from engineering to education, and it made sense because I was going from engineering to major in English. And I went through my summers and took social minor and a science minor. I used my red journeyman seal carpentry to help me when I was doing my CTS department heads. I've subbed from 1 to 6. I've never been in a kindergarten class other than walking through it because it just scares the hell out of me. I don't know how those people do it. I've taught 7, 8, 9, all the core. I've done phys ed, done numerous options. Senior high English, senior high math. Went with Ron Bradley and wrote the LearnNet part on Lotus Notes when we started up LearnNet down there. I've been a reviewer for McGraw-Hill for a couple textbooks, junior high, senior high. I wrote for The Key, some other stuff. Much like most people, the nice thing about education is you do a lot of things. It worked for me because what you get from all this is I can't hold a job. But what it has resulted in is I've seen a lot of different courses at a lot of different divisions. I've got to do a lot of different assessments, and I've got to see them from different perspectives. I've got to see them from teaching them, and administrating them, and writing them, and reviewing them. So I've got to see a lot of different angles on it. And where this all tied together was in, November this year, I was in a gradebook session. And the gradebook session was talking about some technical aspects, about calculating marks. And, as you can figure out, I'm not really good at paying attention, so my brain was elsewhere. And I was thinking, this is very interesting. We're talking about the technical aspects, but when you think about the whole assessment package, I wonder if some things happened like this, if the results would be this. Well, one of the nice things about the reorganization that's happened downtown is it's easier to get together at departments and talk about things. And so I talked about some people that had the power to look where I wanted to look. And when we looked, son of a gun, there were some interesting things happening. And what became apparent was that Graybook has been going in with a very solid foundation. Our technical people in the district are very good at what they do. But what hasn't been considered is the pedagogical considerations. That it's being put in from mainly a technical look of making sure the software worked, because that's where the expertise has really been with those putting it in. And not so much about, how does this fit with the philosophies in the schools, with the philosophies of the teachers? How is that meshing together? Because really, kind of wasn't actually meshing, it just was going in solid technically. And that led to where we are today. Because in all those divisions I've been in, what I've noticed is teachers and administrators do a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff. But something's consistent every division I've been in is that teachers plan, teachers teach, they assess, and they report. And the cycle might change a little bit from one to another, but those are the basic cycles. And Gradebook has potential of really impacting on how the assessments are stored and calculated, and how the assessments are reported. Because here's the thing about software. It's not smart, and it's not dumb. But especially this software, it has the ability of reflecting our understanding of what it's doing. Because it's software. It will do exactly what we tell it to do. Nothing more, nothing less. But we may not really understand what we're telling it to do. So when I kind of thought about that, and I thought of some other parts, I thought, maybe we go out and go talk to schools. And they had the concept, everybody understands this, especially administrators, that failing a plan is planning to fail. But a core goes to that. You really need to know what you're planning for. Because if you don't really understand what it is you're planning for, odds are you're going to miss the target. Because they're kind of the same. When you look at SIS, it's got a top part and it's got three underneath. And when you look at gradebook, it's got all three parts. But they're not actually kind of the same. Because very few people actually set this up with term 1, 2, 3. This first bin was usually used for units or some other part of the calculations for those that use miscalculating. And they actually have three levels. Well, gradebook only has two levels that can be used. Because this one is tied up with the terms. You actually only have two levels of categories and assignments. And they're in the start line of first issue. Those that use it as calculations, were trying to shoehorn exactly what they did in SIS into a different kind of setup and didn't understand necessarily that it wasn't really different. Because as I mentioned, in the office, you can set up reporting periods. And so for a semester course, it's pretty obvious. You have September to November when the first reports go out, and then you have it to January. Full year courses, you gotta start having choices. You might do it by cumulative. And that means that the first one might go from, say, September to November. The second one include everything from September to March. The third one includes everything from September to June. And in this school, it goes to June 22nd, because at the very final one, they add in final exam marks. Now, everything you see in this presentation is from our district, being used, has been used. Most of it has been used before. The only time it's not is when there's any names on it. Or if I say it's a mock-up. And you can tell it's cumulative because everything starts in September. Conversely, some schools want to have reporting periods. They're discrete. They only want to report by term, things that are happening within, from November to March. Only things that are happening from March to June. And you can tell the difference because the starting periods are the same, are different. And the final year one will include everything, of course. Now here's the thing. This is the only part of the grade book that can be set up centrally. Every other piece is set up by every individual teacher. I used to say every individual teacher individually, until it was pointed out you're repeating yourself, so now I try to believe you. Because when we start looking at the reporting periods themselves. Inside it, there's three choices of how you might want to set it up as a teacher. You might want to set up a total points. Well, pretty self-explanatory, you take all the points and total them up. You might want to set them up with term weights. Well, that's pretty self-explanatory, there's lots of people that do that, where they set each term is 1/3 of the marks. Well, that's where my contention that perhaps there needs to be discussions. Because personally, I don't know of many curriculums that are evenly divided into thirds. And I don't know many of teachers that sit down, look at their year plan and go, okay, I have this many assessments, now if I divide it evenly into thirds, it'll fall like this. Because that's the contention we're making here. Or, the most common one, of course, is category weights of various different kind of categories. So this teacher in term one has categories and has it set up with weightings of 40, 30, 40 compared to each other, which goes into percent. Now here's the next part of understanding software. Software works out of 100%. That's all it ever actually works out of, 100%. Because in first term, this is what this setup is. In second term, and it didn't drop the lowest ones. Because you can tell the software to drop the lowest mark. Of course, you have to be careful, because if you have one quiz you did that term, it will drop it. It's software. It will do what it's told. In second term, the teacher did this. For some reason, the project and labs were a little more important. So they dealt with that by changing it to a weighting of 40. Now, what they don't think they really realized is that everything changes. Because if you take a portion off of one, it will take everything. So it adds up evenly to 100. So the result is that every project, every quiz, and the exams done in term two were weighted differently than what they were in term one. And so they're worth different amounts. Now, that's okay. Perhaps that was done with reason to do it. My question would be, was that communicated to all the parents? Was that communicated to all the students? Is that how the whole school does it? Is this part of a plan? This is a lot of the contention of my discussion today, is that gradebook should be reflecting the school assessment plan, and that it should be being done thoughtfully. Because they also dropped the lowest quiz in this term. Was that communicated? And why was it done this term but not the first? Now the interesting part, third term went back to like the first term. So now it was different than the term before. And was that communicated? And was that a part of a plan that the whole school is doing? Because when I went out and talked to the schools, different schools had discovered varying aspects of gradebook and how they had implemented to varying degrees when it came to their assessments. But what they said was, what they had found is, the most important part is having consistency. And to have consistency, you have to have a baseline everybody understands. You have to have a school assessment plan that everybody's on board with. For larger schools, you have to have departments that are talking the same language and doing the same things. Because it's very easy, when everybody's not consistent, for interesting things to happen. For instance, in categories. This is grade 9 math course. This teacher has set it up so it's total points. Nothing wrong with that. This teacher has set it up using category weights, and there's nothing wrong with that. They have their assignments grouped in quizzes, is what's been done. So they have assignments at 30, they got a final exam at 25, they have homework at 0. Because what this teacher has is a belief that homework shouldn't have a value attached to it. Now there's another discussion. Because it's not uncommon in the same school to see some classes where homework is value with marks, and some where marks aren't assigned. And you wonder, should the same school have different philosophies in different classes? In some schools, one division includes homework and another division doesn't. And again, you wonder, why is it that it's included in one division and not the other? Final exam, this is math 9. And final exams were 25%. And you know, that's fairly common. But we got like 20% of our teachers new in the last 5 years. It's surprising these days how many people think a PAT is worth 25%. Well, of course, they have no value. The only value on any government exam is the diploma at 50%. We talk about how interesting it is that we take one assessment and put a huge value on it. Yet, we do it ourselves all the time. 25%, right there, of one. And I was going to say this about PATs, is that they are valid and reliable. They're made by teachers. They're field tested. They're tied directly to curricular outcomes. And if you said which one each one question is, write down the details. What about our grade 7 tests? What about our grade 8 tests? They're often made by teachers in isolation. And these days, they're made often by pulling marks off a publisher's bunch of questions, of which we have no idea how they were made, who they were made, and we just trust that they are tied to what we say they're tied to. And I don't know, when I went through, I sure didn't have many courses in making useful assessments. And I would argue that if you read Popham and you look at assessments and compare them to some of the ones we run through, that probably they're not as valid and as reliable to the point of saying 1/4 of the student's mark of that year is clearly assessed on this exam. And what happens here? 45, 25. 70% of that course is on tests. Is that one that's thoughtfully designed? Or is it simply that's kind of gone all this time? Is that what the school assessment plan is? Don't know. This teacher uses category weights in grade 9 and has it set up by the strands. Now, you have three different teachers, same course, three different ways of doing it. And there's other ways. But what's interesting about this is that these are different teachers. And you might think they're from different schools, but they're not. So think about what that means. I can do an assessment in this class. Do you think it's the same value as this one or this one when it's calculated out? If I had two students in math 9 in this school, and they had the same marks, and they came out with different marks, which is entirely plausible. So, what I get to do, because you know what, as we go through this, it's a huge amount of information. On this sheet, it talks about year setup, administrative supported gradebook, and categories. Whether it's going to be cumulative or whether it's going to be by terms, that's a school decision. My question would be, could a teacher at that school articulate why they're choosing one or the other and how it fits into their assessment philosophy and how it's justified by their assessment philosophies? Has it been thought of, or is it just simply this is what's done at that school always? And what about categories? Which ones are being used? Which ones are planning to be used? Which ones make sense? Is it different? So maybe turn to an elbow partner for a couple minutes, or think of it yourself before I start down here, because this shifts into another area. I know, awesome first conversation kind of turned to, what have you been doing all year? What have you been doing on the weekend? Things kind of fade along. And all that, there's time at the end to talk about it in more depth. The next part is about clear communication. And really, talking about the interim reports. Because we communicate many different ways. We phone parents, we send progress reports out, but increasingly, the interims are used as a stopgap message to make sure that there's communication of the students' progress as we're going. But before we get there, sometimes it helps to wrap your head about everything to understand some of the issues of the whole grade book, Power School, Power Teacher, and why you're here. SIS works pretty good. But so why are we moving to Power School, Power Teacher, and grade book? Well, because the language that SIS is supported, that SIS is built on, it's no longer supported. It's going dead. It's not going to be updated anymore. It's kind of like if we chose to keep using Windows 3.1. It could be done. But by this point, if we were on 3.1, you'd see a lot of problems with that. So, there's a second part. The Alberta government put out new requirements. Part of it is changing to a web-based one, a web-based reporting system. We report to them and it's all web-based. So we could write one ourselves. I mean, we did that with SIS, because district technology, ITS, that's pretty impressive that they wrote SIS. All in-house, that's amazing. But those that have been around for a few years kind of remember the beginning of SIS. I remember the beginning of SIS. I was an administrator of SIS right from the beginning. I remember losing entire term marks with the school. It never came back. Because right back in those days, it was take backups. And they were, but when we went to check in, we found they were blank. So they were gone because we had lost the SIS marks and they weren't on take backup. They lost the entire term of marks. And then there's some other ones that people have been around remember. Remember when the marks would change? During the day, individual marks would simply change. And this was not believed, because who would believe that when you're creating it? What do you mean the marks are changing? So we had to start taking screenshots on the hour. And then once we had enough of them, we could lay them out to prove that the marks were changing. Because, right, you had to have an idea of what to work on. And then, I forgot about this, but it was mentioned in one of my sessions. Remember the disc that we'd take home and work with? Yeah. And you take all your marks home and you work with them, and you work all weekend and you do all kinds of work, except real late at night and you get off and you get going. And you come in, you put the disc in and overwrite everything, it's all gone. That happened more than once.
I didn't do that.
Point being, this SIS is a rock solid one we like right now. but its growing pains were substantial. So there's a couple things. Do we want to start from one that would be even more complicated and go through those growing pains, or do we look around and see if there's anything out there that actually fits all the criteria we need? Well, by coincidence, Pearson has one that fits everything we need, makes all the requirements. Well, this is not a coincidence. Pearson is a huge multinational educational company that looks to the future. So they designed PowerSchool, Power Teacher, and Gradebook to meet requirements around the world. Now, when we put our marks in Gradebook, which is owned by Pearson, they get stored up in the PowerSchool. The Power Teacher is kind of like here in the middle, because I'm just not discussing that aspect of it, which is also owned by Pearson. And then it's stored into the district database, which clearly is us. Now, anything in these areas are owned by Pearson and are patented and cannot be changed except by Pearson. So our interim student report comes out of the Pearson reports. We cannot go and change it as we want. We can put in requests to have changes made. Pearson actually has that. Districts put in requests. And so we have many requests that go in. But we are one district. Granted, we're a large district, 70,000 people. And it's about 60% of Alberta on Pearson. All of Nova Scotia, other provinces starting up. Brookside States, where Pearson is used extensively. Population of roughly 250 million. Actually, Pearson's in 65 different countries around the world. It runs through Europe, it gets used in Asia, it gets used in Australia. As far as I know, it's not used in Antarctica. But it's used extensively. And everybody gets to have input on what's important to them for their system, because everybody's systems are kind of different. So will there be changes real quick to what we see? Probably not. So the contention is that it becomes behoven on us to understand what's there, embrace it, and use it the way we want it to be used. Not look at it and say, this is how it works, and we adapt to it. It should be, here's our assessment policies. Here's what we decided. Now, how are we going to make that work the best for our assessment policies? Because the individual student report is Pearson. When you look at progress IPP modules, they're written in-house. It looks amazingly like the last one, because for all intents and purposes, it is. We can only work on a few things at a time. We have a very small stable of programmers. So what they have managed to do is make it so that the report marks follow a trend that we can use here. But these ones and the report at this point in time are locked down. Will it change in the future? Perhaps. But when? Don't know for sure. Only thing, so many things can be done at once. There's a nice thing about Gradebook. You can see what's included in the marks very easily. It's bolded. And as a teacher, you can see what's not included very easily. It's nicely grayed out. But when an intern goes to parents, nothing's grayed out. You cannot tell what's included. As a parent, you cannot tell what is included. It all is bold. So some schools recognize this, and different schools deal with it different ways. At this school, for formative assessments, they put in 0.0. And then they went and they had a discussion with their parent community. And they said, every time you see 0.0, that means that that assignment's not included in the actual calculations. And you can see it works, because you have total possible 300. And that comes from the 100, 200, 300 of this one that is included. Now notice that this is 100, and this is 100 points possible, and that's 100 points possible, because that has some ramifications later, and I'll refer to it. And also, you notice that this blue is included, and this white isn't. Blue's included, white isn't. Blue's included, white isn't. That's coincidence. I went in there and said, why'd you do all that? Look, the blue's included, and the white's isn't. I said, you went through a lot of trouble when it's pretty obvious you missed this boat. And unfortunately, it was someone I knew quite well who kind of gave you a really strange look and said, well, have you ever done that's just a coincidence, because if you look up here, that's blue, that's white, that's blue, that's white.
Oh.
So it's just that it's for readability. Yeah. And unfortunately, it was somebody who knew me really well, but I still hear it every day. In this one, this school chose to do it differently. What they've done is they put zero on all their formative assessments. And then you can see that the summative ones have marks for them. But they went one further. This school uses two categories, formative and summative. And that's all they use. Everybody fits everything into it. And they match you by a lot of discussions. And all the formative ones are set at zero. They have no value to them. And that was a much different discussion with the parent community. Because now the discussion is, what's a formative assessment? What's a summative assessment? And also, who actually has those discussions? The teachers. And to be able to talk coherently about it, the teachers have to understand it very well and make sure that what they have set up matches what they're talking to parents about. And then there's letter grades. Sometimes people forget that a letter has no meaning to software, really. Because this software is built with calculating power. So when you put in an A, you actually put in 90%. 90% of whatever points possible is. And it gets to the 90 by looking at the cutoffs. Between 80 and 100 is 90%, halfway. So what it does, it looks at every cutoff. So when it makes a B, it puts in 73, because that's halfway between 65 and 80. For the C, it puts in 58. D puts in 40% of it. NA and PMU, they won't be there next year. PMU, performance mark unavailable, is meant to be used for term assessment. And it ended up starting to be used in individual assignments. So rather than go back and try to retrain an entire district and talk about, oh, use it this way, this way, it'll just be re-geared to individual assess evidence unavailable. Don't be able to use gentlemen.
I think it was IEA, wasn't it?
IEA. Individual evidence unavailable. It'll be communicated in September by student assessment. And what it is the term mark. And for those that use PMU, you'll understand it and recognize the differences. Because here's what happens. This is a junior high using letter grades. We have 15 junior highs using letter grades right now. And some people say, well, you don't want to be using a letter grade in junior high because high schools don't like it. Well, really, it doesn't actually affect them whatsoever anymore. Because if you have B and C, that fits most of the courses going in. 10C is B and C. Math 10C, English 10 is BC. Social 10 is BC. Science 10 is BC. If people are looking to stream people off for honors, for PIB, for PAP, here's A's. If you're looking for 13 levels, you're gonna have ones that are below the C. So it does work these days. But if you put out an intern, you not only get your letters, you also get all the percentages, you get the points possibles, and you get the scores that the computer's using. Well, this clearly is not probably what schools that use letter grades want to communicate, whether it's a junior high or whether it's an elementary that's allowing the software to calculate the letter grades. Because when you put in an A, this is what it's doing. So that's why it puts it out. Because it believes this is what you want to communicate. When you do B, it takes 73% of the point possible, what the score is out of, and it puts in the score. This school has dealt with it by making all the points possible for all the scores out of 3, A, B, C. So what happens is you tell the parents, these first 3 columns, don't look at them. Just look at the last one, because that's what we do. We're a letter grade school. Right. Really, that's your choice. It's either that, or you don't put out interns. Several schools chose no interns, because it doesn't make sense. What's nice is it kind of summarizes it down here. And you'll notice that down here, there's no final mark. Because this school didn't want them to talk about final mark, wanted them talking about the assignments and everything. But they put this in so it's summarized for them. Well, you're a parent, what do? You look at C, B, B, A, you kind of figure out where Johnny is. Johnny's probably a B, right? You got a C, an A, B's. Except Johnny's here. Why is Johnny an A? Well, because on the interim, what wasn't considered was, you can't tell what's included, you can't tell what is included. Because everything's reported, and it's all bold. So although there's some parts considered, some parts weren't. And this is the problem with gradebook. Not the problem, but the consideration. Everything's interconnected. And you have to understand how everything's interconnected. You have to understand what you want to communicate, how you want to communicate it. Because I was at a catchment area grouping, and I was asked how to move it so it looked like that last one with the formative and summative. Forgot how much I have here now. With the formative and summative ones on the side, but using their language. And what language they use, assessment of and assessment for. Because there are those who say that assessment for learning is exactly the same as formative. Personally, I would argue it's not. You listen to Williams, of Williams and Black, who came up with formative assessment. Formative assessments is what you do right now, every day, in your classroom, to make a difference. Right up to even the next slip that makes a difference on the next class. But it's things you're doing. Whether it's popsicle sticks, the use of popsicle sticks, turning cups over, writing on boards, raising hands even. Whereas assessment for learning are assessments that are completed and recorded, but aren't included in the marks. Well, I see a big differentiation between those two. So this group, anyway, wants to use assessment of and assessment for. So, in front of the assignment, there's AOL for assessment of learning. And what happens is, when the intern's made, you can just leave like this. And here's the other part of gradebook. There's no one item I can think of in gradebook that can only be done one way. And to me, that's the power of gradebook. Everything can be done more than one way. But there's only one real issue with gradebook in my eyes. There's no one thing in gradebook that can only be done one way. Everything in gradebook can be done more than one way. And every individual teacher adjusts every parameter other than just the reporting periods at the very top. So this is how it ended up. And they looked at it and they said, well, that's great. They said, but we don't want them looking at earlier semesters. We don't want them looking at a summary. We want to just have the parents focusing on the categories. Sorry, the assignments. Well, that's not hard. Because you can turn off the final grades. You can turn off the categories. And now the intern would look like this. And they said, well, that's nice. They said, but we want it to go further. We want it like the formative and summative. So how was that done? Well, what this happened was, there's two categories made. Assessment for learning with a weight of 0, and assessment of learning with a weight of 100. And then, every time an assignment is made, in this case, it's assessment for learning. And it's got to include the final grade. So, what's nice is you can take off the AOL and AFL, and you would end up with this. Assessment of, assessment for. Will they get to this everywhere this year? No. But it's clear that this is the direction they're heading. Now inside gradebook, there are comments built into it that you can use. Exempt, missing, great little things for understanding what's happening inside your assignments. But here's the problem. They show up in the teacher's gradebook, but they don't show up on the intern report. However, teacher codes do. So this is what I'm talking about. This is built in. You can click on exempt. It'll show up in the teacher's gradebook, nicely grayed out. Or You could use a teacher one that will show up under grades, and you might have not yet complete, and it shows up exactly the same way in the grade book. But there's massive differences on how they show up in the interim reports. So here's a mock-up of what they might look like. And you can see that C means there's a comment on it. L means that that one's built in, it stands for late. This is what they would look like on interims. So if you have exempt, which is a built-in one, and you have a comment, it would show up like this. Exempt doesn't show up at all. The comment does. But if you had a teacher-created one, say it was XMT or whatever that school decided on, the XMT does show up, as does the comment. And it could be argued, well, why wouldn't you just put it in the comment? And you could, school decision. Now you're sending two messages inside one comment. Is that what you want to do? If so, that's fine. School's decisions, their assessment plans. For late, if there's no comment, this shows up. Nothing. But if you put in not yet complete as a co-teacher code and no comment, the not yet complete does show up. And it could be argued, even if it's not yet complete, there should always be a comment. But there's 4,000 teachers. That means there's a lot of kids, 70,000. A lot of things happen. Sometimes they get missed. It's like a fail-safe. School decisions. They're easy to make. Every teacher can go to teacher preferences, go to codes, enter NYC for not yet complete. NYC, NHI, which one would you use? NHI, not handed in. A lot of finality there, not handed in. A lot of things happen with that. You know what? It's not handed in. You've got to teach these kids lessons. You got to put inside a mark in there, you got to make sure, you know, we're not handed in. Who's going to teach them how to behave if it's not us? Not yet complete is much different. Not yet complete has the idea of, you know, we gave this assignment, this assessment is vital. And yeah, it's not in yet, Johnny doesn't know, it's just not yet complete. Johnny's not going to do this. So you have not yet complete, which has no value to it. High schools might have something like INS if they want, which would be less than half the attendance and less than half the work done. It's a credit system. And it has meaning to it. And it could even assign a value that could be changed by the individual teacher. But it puts it in the rough value where they might want it. But, you know, the thing is, every teacher will make their own codes however they want. So a teacher could put in NEE with not enough effort and assign a zero. Teacher can put in NHI and assign a zero. Every individual teacher in your school can put in different codes and put in different marks or no marks. And there are schools that have different codes running with different values. And there are some teachers, some parents, that look at interims and see different codes with different meanings. And there are some that look at the same codes with different meanings. Because in elementary, you've got your elementary main teacher, and you've got two or three others. You've got your USA, maybe your Franks, some sort of specialists. You went up in Div 3, you've got more teachers. Div 4. And every individual teacher has control over not just individual codes and categories, but how the interim looks. And every individual teacher, without it being organized and discussed and talked about what you're going to do and why, will do it. Because here's my other contention about this whole issue. Our students in this district are resilient. You hear that word a lot. My contention is, our teachers are very resilient. We take a new piece of software, we say, here's the buttons and how they work. Now make that work. And they have been doing so. But have they been supported through it? One wonders. Because we have the teaching process we talked about earlier. And we believe our teachers should not be islands. And we give them support. And I would wager, probably not a teacher in this district won't have some sort of administrator walk through that classroom. Make sure that real teaching's happening, talk about what you're doing, talk about assessments, make sure they're not killing kids, basics. On the flip side, We send out a lot of report card remarks, a lot of report card comments. And I would argue, probably none of those comments go home without some administrator looking at them, making sure the comments match up to what's happening in the mark, make sure that it all blends together, to the point where sometimes it's even, you know, correcting the grammar. But between all the work that's done about teaching and assessing and talking about theories of assessment, talking about theories of teaching, and then it's put into the magic box. And then on the other side, we talk all about comments about what came out of that magic box. Because I would contend very few administrators looked in SIS to see if anything made sense. Because that's what we're going to talk about next. So I'll take a little stop, because it's going to shift gears again to another very different area. I'll give you a chance to talk about that part, which is the individual school report setup, and how it might fit into earlier talks here. With the implementation of Green Book, that every issue that could possibly arise really is part of a school discussion. And that when the schools that talked about how well it's working there, what they've done, they've had those discussions. And that's what they talk about when they say consistency. And as Scott says, there has to be some leeway sometimes. Because different programs, even within the same school, will sometimes have slightly different philosophies. If, for instance, Kokato may have slightly different ideas than, say, Waldorf. Recording assessments. One that I always find interesting about it is ones like Dusky and Daly. And they say, for all our advantages, however, electronic grade books also have their shortcomings. Perhaps most serious is that many educators believe the mathematical precision of computerized grading programs yields greater objectivity in grading. Others believe this increased precision enhances fairness in the grading process. Unfortunately, neither of these beliefs is true. Computerized grading programs, electronic grade books, yield neither greater objectivity nor enhanced fairness. At best, they offer teachers a tool for manipulating data. Although these programs may make record keeping easier, they do not lessen the challenge involved in assigning grades that accurately and fairly reflect students' achievement and level of performance. And I agree with them completely. But the reality is that the grade books are used for manipulating data quite often. And it needs to be really well understood for those that allow it to manipulate data on how the data is being manipulated and how it fits into the assessment theories that the teachers are trying to have it represent. To give you some idea of why it might be important to understand how the grade book manipulates data, I made up three assignments. Made one 6 out of 10, 25 out of 28, 47 out of 49. And in grade book parlance, when an assignment is made up out of 10, it's points possible. So points possible 10, points possible 28, 49, and then you have the student scores. So it's software. It does it the way software would. It adds up the points possible, it adds up the student scores, divides, multiplies by 100, gets a percentage, and that's fine. Now this would be like points possible, total points possible. And many people do that. Then you ask teachers, talk to me about how your assignments are set up. Tell me about your assessments. Tell me what they're worth in comparison to each other. Why do you have them set that way? And often they can say, well, this one is worth a lot more than that one. And this one is more than that one, less than that one. And you might say roughly 3 times, roughly 4 times, roughly 5 times. Now it depends on the divisions. For some divisions, that's fine. For some divisions, if it's points possible, one would hope that you could probably articulate a little better about what assignments are worth. Because in this case, assignment 3 is 57%. But especially, I would say that in our higher divisions, one would expect a little more accuracy in being able to communicate how it's being made up if the score or grade book is used for calculating assessments. Because here's the next consideration. As we all know, what it's out of really doesn't necessarily mean its value. So say the first assignment's actually worth more than the other two. What does the teacher do? Well, weights it more. It's worth twice the amount of the other ones. But gradebook never multiplies against percentages. Gradebook only ever multiplies against points possible and what the student gets. So what gradebook does, it takes 6 out of 10, multiplies by 2 over 2, and gets 12 out of 20. Then, it dutifully adds together points possible, adds together the student scores, divides, multiplies by 100, gets a percentage. This is pretty seductive, because for a teacher, they don't see any of this. What they see is they have this assignment, they weighted it 2, and they get this. They move on. But this is what they've done. Assignment 1 is still worth less than assignment 2, and nowhere near assignment 3 in value compared to each other. Because here's what has to be understood. If the points possible are different, then this assignment in value compared to each other is being driven by these numbers. And when you double that number, it's in value compared to the next ones is still quite a bit less. Because what teachers are used to, they're used to SIS. They're used to a raw score column and then that nice little percentage column. That percentage column is not just a percentage column. It's a percentage out of 100 for every single assignment. And over the years, this was developed this way to meet the needs of using a scalar. Because what SIS does, it never multiplies against the raw score of a scalar, it multiplies against the percentage out of 100. Because the values are equal to each other because they're all out of 100. If you want to use weighting so that they're actually in value to each other, you have to convert it to percents, but it has to be out of 100. And it's not that it's difficult to do in gradebook. There's a mythology around that it is. Remember that one that had the intern report and all the assignments were out of 100? That's because that school realized that to use scalar properly, use weighting properly, you had to have a percentage out of 100. And what they did is they said all assignments will be out of 100. And at that school, every assignment was hand done to 100 by every individual teacher on a calculator, so that they could have the gradebook work effectively the way they needed it to. Other schools say everything will be out of 25. As long as they're equal value to each other, it can be done. But now it's happening. Either the software is driving the assessment practices, or teachers are doing amazingly amounts of calculations, and as we all know, every time you do a calculation, it opens up an error possibility. But if we wanted to have the gradebook do it, so that they're all out of 100, because once they're all out of 100, they're all equal to each other. And this is simply because it's rounded. It's easy to do. So I made one up. I use 6 out of 10, because we know that this will end up being 60%. All you have to do is look at the points and points possible. If you change points possible to 100, and on the drop-down menu, pick percentage, when you click save, it goes to a percentage out of 100. That's it. That's all it has to be done. It actually works inside the gradebook, despite all the misinformation that's out there. I would make one suggestion that if you make a change, that you also write what the original score was down there. Because I've been down here almost 3 years now, out of the schools, and it's been brought to my attention. And this will be shocking, and some of you might be aware of it in your schools. But it turns out, not every student hands the assignments in on time. If it's not handed in on time, teachers need to have the marks come in later, or they might use most recent evidence and change marks. Well, there's two ways. Those that are mathaholics, they simply say, you put in a percent, you just do it yourself. Not everyone likes to use calculators and percentages. So you can always take this mark, put it back in here, change this back to points, it'll go back. It'll flip back and forth that way every time. It works like a charm, and it does work. And trust me, because I've gone to high schools, and you can bet the whole math department immediately sits down and calculates it with the X number of percentages and says, oh, okay, it does work. Because this is what it's doing. It's still never calculating against a percentage. It's still only ever multiplying against points possible and student score. But now when you double it, when it adds them together, does the software a bit, grounds it. In comparison to the others, its value is twice as much. And many schools got that. They were very happy. The song was singing out, the bell rang, and everybody was going good. But what they fail to consider is, what happens if, say, you add another assignment to that wonderful setup? Because now, you have it adding up to 500 worth of scores. And this one is to be twice the amount of the others. Well, it is. It's worth twice the value of the others, but it's only 40% of the category, right? Because the values of these are equal, but the value of this one is twice compared to those, but now it's 40%, it's not 50%. Sometimes this escapes people. What if another weighted assignment's added? Well, software does what it's supposed to, and here's another part. Teacher has control of clicking a button and decide whether it gets rounded or truncated. Truncated means it simply cuts the mark. If it cuts it at a truncate, this would be 79, so because it just cuts this off. If it's rounded, it's an 80. Another part of a school discussion about what we do in our schools. Do we use truncated? Do we use rounded? Because you wouldn't want your, say, physics 20 class between truncated and physics class doing rounded, or your English, etc. But if another one's weighted, it's added, and in this case it's rounded, it does it the same way, and this one's value is twice those, but they add up to 66% of the course, right? Because it's in value to the others. And so this is where the contention comes. If you're going to allow a gradebook to be a calculating of the marks, you really need to understand what it's doing. So make sure it's doing what you think it's doing. In this one, this teacher multiplies everything by weightings of various amounts. I put it in a chart so you can kind of see it. These are the original scores. Here's the weightings that are used on this section. And this is what this teacher's done. This teacher didn't do this thoughtlessly. This teacher kind of understands how these run. Now what the teacher's done is made it so that the baseline's around 200, and things are supposedly compared to 200. But of course, the problem is that the teacher doesn't fully understand what's happening. So what the teacher's really doing is this. And although this quiz is supposed to be the same as this quiz, you're actually not. Because they're kind of got the concept, but not the whole concept. There's some understanding, but not full. And here's the other part of that. This is the actual interim for that one. What you notice is, you can't tell that different quizzes are worth different amounts. You just see there's three quizzes. It becomes clear communication. Does everybody understand what's happening? Is it being clearly communicated what the setup is? Might be that on a separate piece of information, it was sent out what each quiz was worth. It might be. This teacher's does it much differently. There's 40 assignments through here. There's blue and non-blue. I use non-blue because depending on the screen, it changes and I'm colorblind. I can see blue and there's another color that all of you see different. And my contention is, you all need help. But the blue ones are all multiplied at 7 every time. The red ones, green ones, these ones, not blue, are all multiplied by 3 every single time. And everything's out of 4. Now, at first I thought, oh man, they all another bizarre one. But I actually got to talk to this person. This is done. Understanding the software fully. Because 4 times 7 is 28. 3 times 4 is 12. 28, 12. 73 ratio. 70% of this course are these blue categories. 30% are the red categories. It's all out of 4 to make sure it works. So you have the consistent equal value. So the weighting works the way they want it to work. Second, it's all out of 4 because they use check marks on the way that they mark everything. They have rubric set up. And everything's done very quickly and efficiently using a checklist system. And so it all worked, 70%, 30%. grade book, is that you can make the final judgments on term change by the teacher very easily. You can see it's changed, because A, this is bold, and B, the one above it, 76, is a B. And it's easy to do. You click manual override, and you change the letter grade in this case. You can also do it with percentages. You have percentages. All you do is click the manual override. And in this case, they change both the grade and the percent. And there's points. And what this person did is actually put in a comment as well. Well, this becomes important, especially if you kind of like to do it forward, because if you're going to have a final assessment that may not correspond for whichever reason to all your other assessments, if you have built into it the fact that it's based on teacher judgment, that's much different than just having a mark which is different than your record of marks. I would suggest that this is a very good practice. Now, something that came up, of course, is the letter grades. For schools that use letter grades, end up not using interns because of this plethora of stuff they don't want. Don't want those scores, don't want the percents, don't want total points earned, don't want percentages. Well, it's no wonder many schools just stop using interns. I would say this is a crying shame. I'd say from personal experience, my daughter in grade 5 had an intern come home, and yes, the marks on it had gone down a little, and yes, they weren't very bad marks, and therein lies the problem. They were actually still fairly good marks. But we know our daughter. We're the first line, we know our students, but we don't know them like our parents. And so we talked to our daughter and we said, what's going on here? Because we know what you're capable of, and this doesn't seem to be it. And you seem to be working hard. We seem to be doing everything the same. What's changed? Well, here's a story that we've all heard before. She was trying to fit into a group. And to fit in with this group, she was making her marks fit into what that level of the group was. Because she was seen as being too far above them. So she was dropping everything down to fit into the group. And we were able to have that discussion. But would that have happened without that intern? Probably not. Because we're pretty good at focusing on those where it's dropping down pretty low, but at the very high end, what they drop down to is still considered good. So the intern was important to us, but that's a personal story. So there's ways of using interns without having all that appear. It's by using the teacher codes. It's by manipulating the software to do what we want it to do. And I've had it suggested that perhaps that's not a best practice, but I believe it is. I would say that if we put in an AA, we can make it say meets excellent standards. We can put in BB and say exceeds, CC, because they're teacher codes. So this is how it will come out. It'll come out grayed out. A couple things. Nothing gets calculated. We can record the assignments. Nothing gets calculated at all. If you want it on an intern to show what current mark is, you would have to make one that says current mark. Nothing's calculated. The teacher would have to look at the body of evidence and enter each one for each student using completely their professional judgment. Because they would enter whatever the assessment ended up being. Then they would put that in if it's chosen to have it. And it would look like this. On the intern, there's no scores. There's no percents. Points possible is whatever you make it. You can have points possible as zero. You can have points possible, whatever the school decides it's going to be, because it's independent. There's nothing calculated. All that happens is these are being coming in. And they're not calculating at all. You can choose not to have current mark. You simply don't make a column that says current mark.
Anthony, sorry, could you just back up a screen again and just explain the current marks column again?
Where? So,
because I'm just trying to figure out what distinguishes that from the other columns. Other than
because this is the column I make up for going on my intern, and it's blank. Okay. So I would look at these columns,
right,
and then I would enter the mark. As opposed to the current system, if you put in A's and B's, it calculates.
Right.
And it would take a calculated mark from here and shows up on the green book. So if you didn't have a current mark, you would just have the assignments reported. That becomes, again, discussion at the school. What is the assessment philosophy of that school? What is the discussions? What are we all talking about? What do you think we should do? This is what we're all, how we're all going to do it.
Can you go back to that one screen? The previous screen, just for one.
This is all on.
Is it all online?
Yep. It's, and it gets updated every couple of days, as you know,
where is
it? As it changes. And I go through that weirdly.
And where?
So people will take shots and stuff. This is all on district technology website? PowerSchool website.
PowerSchool website.
PowerSchool website. And you need to check back, because those who have seen it before will tell you that it updates constantly as different things happen. So you might say, well, this is nice, but is there an easy way of communicating to my parents? Sure there is. But on the top of all things, you can always enter allegedly, because you have the ability to make a comment that will go on every one of the interms. So you can go AA equals A, BB equals B, CC equals C, DD equals D. And I've had the question, well, what will you say to your parents? And I always say, tell them the truth. We're having the software meet our assessment philosophy needs. And to make it happen, this is how we're making it work. Because our assessments and your child is what drives how we use the software.
Can you explain, sorry, Anthony, why you need two letters? Like, why AA? Do you need
because,
two letters?
Because, you need at least two good question. But when the time comes to actually put in a report card part, you have to use the ones that are the actual district standards. So if you put in an A, it would go over here to an A and go up. Now, if you use these A's, what happens? It goes in as an A, it's 90% of whatever's there. If you put it in as an AA, it's a teacher code, and nothing happens. You could theoretically make teacher codes of A, but where is the inherent danger there? They get mixed up, and the teacher gets mixed up.
Could the same apply to the descriptors that are standard?
Good question. You could do it by descriptors as well. You could go MSE, meets standard of excellence. Although, as I understand it, those descriptors may change for HCAR, new inversion, but it would still be the ability to have it so that you could do the same concept.
So a parent could read that comment rather than see a letter.
Yes, and as those that are on the descriptor world, and we have a couple of junior highs running descriptors now, I know at least one of them enters it in points. The points convert to percents. They convert the percents to letters, send the letters out to the district database. The district database takes those letters, converts it to a descriptor for the report card. Because that's the way the system works.
So Anthony, the way that it is on the screen right now, this is teacher by classroom created, not school-wide created codes.
Right.
So you, for consistency in your school, you have to have that discussion that these are the codes we're going to use in this situation.
No, I would venture you wouldn't have that discussion. I would venture that discussion would be part of the overall discussion you're having about your assessment philosophies that you're using at that school.
Okay.
Because gradebook, as you start to see, is totally interconnected. And it's interconnected and should be driven by an interconnected and carefully thought out assessment philosophy of a school.
Anthony, sorry to interrupt, but the number of characters you can have as far as the acronym for whatever the descriptor is there a limitation on that?
I mean, well, I would put that to an expert.
Is there a limitation? No.
There is, okay. And I looked it up once and I don't remember what the number was.
Okay. I think off
but
the, my head,
it's not 10.
Three or six.
Yeah, it's quite short. It's,
oh, three
yeah.
or four.
Exactly.
Three or six tends to seem to be the ones that we keep seeing, but don't quote us on that. So also, it's hoped by next year that perhaps what we can do, same as an A, and an A really is just a code, that we could have a code which would represent descriptors in our district grade scale, so that you could actually put in a descriptor here instead of an A that would then get sent, which continues to be slightly confusing for teachers. And it would then be consistent all the way across. Here's another IEA. For schools that use formative and summative, or even setting up their units, gradebook reports by the date the assignment's put in. So what drives how it shows on your interns is the dates. So you have formative assessment here, and you have a summative and a formative here, and a summative, et cetera, et cetera. Well, what you could do is you could take all your formative assessments, put them on the first date of that time period. Because they're formative assessments. And if you put them all on the first day of that time period, inside the grade book, it'll show up alphabetically. But inside the intern report, they'll show up in the order that they were created. Which is an interesting little twist. But it's understanding what we want to happen, because people said, well, you know, it'd be nice to be able to group assessment for an assessment of. So it was kind of looked at, how could it happen? Well, there's a way it happened. Because these dates are all the same, the assessment for. You could always put a date behind it if that's important. Some schools say that's not important. That becomes a discussion at the school level. Do we even want to do it this way? That's another discussion at the school level about how we want the interns to look, because we're thoughtfully thinking about how all our interns are going to look when they go to parents. Okay, and so I think we're ready to talk about that kind of thing before we kind of look at some of the other issues. Because that's kind of talking about assignment calculations and scorecards. Gradebook running. Many of our teachers have a good understanding of philosophy of their assessments and talk about things and know what they're doing. And I know for sure because I see the report card comments and I see those marks and they all seem to be happening. What might actually be happening? Well, this is a junior high French course. We notice a few things when we look at this course. We notice that greetings are far more important than nouns. We also notice that although often the concept of a test is thought that it is worth more than a quiz, in this case it's not. What we actually are looking at is that a teacher doesn't understand what the gradebook is doing to the assessments that teacher is using, allowing the gradebook to calculate. This is a diploma course. This is unit one of four. All four units are exactly the same. The reason they have zeros is that all of these together are worth less than 1%. All the students had to do in this course is actually do well on that unit exam. If they really want to do really good, they would do good on the lab. Conversely, if they didn't do well on that unit exam, it didn't matter what they did on most of the work because it was irrelevant. And those are marks that students went to university with. In this one, this is a very interesting one. This is one of my favorites. If you look at it, the teacher's multiplying by 0.01. Assignment's out of 10, that means a 7 is worth 0.07. And it's not the only one it happens with. And some say, well, maybe it's their way of having marks not included. Well, no, because they're actually setting up the ones that aren't being included. But what's interesting when you start noticing, this one's out of 22. Student has a 21. 21.07, because they're actually being calculated together. Well, that's not so bad, but what about if you have 14.5 and you have an 80 and 100 and an 80, but you have 14.5? What's being added together here? 14.5, 0.08, 0.1, 0.08. And this is what that course actually looks like. This is what the student's assessment broke out. And it's being, the software is a calculator in this case. Again, right, all the ones with zero is that together they have to be a little less than 1%. Is it the teacher doesn't know what they're doing? I would say no. I would say the teacher has a very clear case of what that teacher wants to do for an assessment. The teacher may not understand is what the how the software actually is working. The teacher needs some collaborative support. In this one, this is a modified test. You can tell it's modified because it actually says modified. It's out of 35. The regular test is out of 49. The rest of the assignments that are included in this part are actually common. So this is what the regular unit looks like. And it's good, because sometimes we have to modify it for whatever reason. Now, of course, here's a part of understanding software. It works out of 100%. If you change the value of part of it, it still works out of 100%. So when you drop it down to 35, it takes those extra percentages and arbitrarily will place them somewhere else unless it's directed how to do it. In this case, students that wrote a modified test, wrote a common final, except theirs was worth more. Probably not what the intent was, that those who had to have it modified would end up writing a common final that was worth more than the regular class. And this one, this is an interesting one, and this is one that shows the importance of collaborative support, because I worked with this for a while before I noticed it. This assignment's got 28, and it's weighted 3. There's 84 marks. Look at the other ones around. How did this happen? Human error. There's still human error that happens all the time. I would argue that often many of these issues, and this is brought up before in some of my presentations, couldn't that happen in CIS? You bet. I bet it's been happening in CIS right now. It goes back to my contention. No one's an island. Everybody gets support in the classroom. Everybody gets support how to assess. And then it goes into the box. Then it comes out. Nobody's an island. We'll all look at the end of the reports and we'll all make sure that the marks are going up and down. We'll do all kinds of data research based on these marks. How did these marks come about? Well, in that little black box that nobody ever looks at. Is the data that we're running our district on really as solid as we think? It's only as solid as what's been calculated. Because in this one, what you notice is that this is 32. But it's a C. Well, this is term one of grade 9 class. So there's a few things happening here. One, it's been set up that this school is doing one third for its terms. Each term is worth a third. When it does one third, it calculates on these percentages. So it's being reported that it's a C on the first report card to the parents and the students. And then 32% is being calculated for the final mark for that term. Because it doesn't use the C, it uses this. Second thought. So if you were a total point school, it would use 87 over 272. Well, you could change that 32 to say 65, because you're a letter grade. You just wanted to round the letter grade ones. But if you were a total point school, and you actually rounded it, you have to change the marks in here if you want it to justify and come up the same. Or else that term mark would be 87 to 272 points. And it would take one third. Third thought. This is a grade 9 course. It's being rounded from 32 to a C, from a D to a C. Should we be rounding every single time we report? Is that clear and accurate communication? Is that what that student's really achieving? Is there a time when you actually communicate where the student is? Because clearly, it might be that the teacher has information in their body of evidence, but when I look at this teacher, every mark below 50 is rounded to a C. It's clearly a policy. And lastly, it's a grade 9 course. It's not just talking about how they're doing in this course. It's communicating to a high school where to place them effectively for their high school course. Do you think that this student is going to be placed effectively in a course that's appropriate for them? Because this will be what they use, and this is where they are. Those all become school discussions. Because here's my contention. Teachers need the ability to teach individually. They need to be able to apply the strategies that fit best for them in their courses and how they do it. They might teach math using drama. A teacher might use math by going outside of school and doing everything hands-on. Another one might do it in rows. But it's the same curriculum. And there should be a solid, same support underlying. And it should be an underlying support built on the assessment philosophies of the school itself. And that it should be solid from classroom to classroom. I should be able to walk from one classroom to another classroom and have the supports there. And it needs to be a collaborative support. Because it's not like SIS. It can't be that it's all talked about and then put into place in September and then everyone's left on their own. Administrators, whether it's principals, APs, department heads, assistant department heads, schools that have been successful have said that every couple months everybody knows that everything will be reviewed. But the problem is there's so much. So I talked to one school at DS McKenzie, and they talked about how they went through the process of talking about everything. And what they figured out at the end when I was talking to Cal was, it was a loss. And so what he did is he wrote it all down. And it's pretty detailed. Wrote it all down, then they all got together again, because this was after several times getting together, and discussed that this indeed was how they did it and reflected their philosophies overall. Now there's again slight differences depending on your grade, depending on your department. But these were the encompassing ones. And then each department has their own that fits theirs. And he said, this did a lot of things for them. One, it surfaced some interesting areas within the school. For instance, even homework. Now they used Matterhort, they had Matterhort and had discussions. That some people believe homework had value in the way of marks. Some believed it was a behavior and had no value, but it became part of the school discussion and it was decided how the school looked at it. It was discussed what the final grades were. That you might use someone like Palm, who talks about things to consider when you make up assessments and the actual construction of tests. Because very few teachers have ever been told how to actually construct them. Yet we all do. How valid, how reliable are they? And now that's ongoing, but a separate issue. But it's surfaced by all the discussions. Also did the same for second progress report and third progress report. Amy Lazard approached it from a different point of view. And this will be up very quickly, so as I have time back to you. Chance to talk to Delia. This is what they use in their kitchen areas to start talking about grade book. And it talks about what their theories is and why they might do it. They talked about the goals that we achieve, why it's good, how it's done in PowerSchool, how it's done for letters and numbers. And it talked again about research. But it was left at a very, very large scale concept. And it was just done with instruction leaders in their kitchen area. Then, for Emmy Lizard itself, what they've created is how they are actually talking about the implementation of it in the grade book. Key points about categories. How they're going to set up AFL and AOL at that school, at the high school level.
Is Kathy letting you put that online?
Yep, it's going to be up this week.
Perfect.
Key points about assignments. Brenda Mulder is a driving force and spent hours on this with a lot of collaborative work with people. That means Lizard plan for the future. Individual student reports and how they're going to do it, so there's consistency. The codes they're going to use, the codes for their assessment for learning and the codes for their assessment of learning. Talking about the calculations, how you might want to do it. Different ways of doing it. What happens when it doesn't work right? How to recognize when it's not working right? And how would you get around to doing it so it does work right? Different ways of doing it again, depending on different departments, how you might want to choose to do it. Different solutions, other than the entire setup. And then the ultimate, use a whole bunch of categories and weight every small category. Yeah, you end up with a lot of things, but you're pretty sure what you're getting. And people sometimes say, well, man, you're going to end up like 30 categories. I go, yeah, you will. TTS people have about 60, because every one of theirs is an individual course. Depends on how each department wants to set it up at that school. But they have guidance on how they're going to do it. And then they discuss it inside. And each department is going to come up with their own. Will anything transfer from one school to another completely? Never. Is there ways of using what's there? Of course. Do people believe in not reinventing the wheel? That's why it's going to be available. I actually printed this one itself off right there. The Japan area one is more of a larger philosophy discussion, although it'll be up there as well. Because there's a lot of things to discuss, and it needs to actually be discussed. It needs to be discussed what the assessment philosophies of the school actually are, and surface what the different concepts are, and come to some sort of agreement on what they are. And how are we going to get support for what areas might need support? How are we going to work on areas where there's a lot of contention? And will it all be completely clean within a meeting? Well, I would be absolutely shocked if you can, without any type of pre-work. Wow. Explains why I'm here, including some principles. Because there's a lot. Cumulative return reporting. I contend it's not enough to have one. Each teacher should be able to communicate why that school does it, how it actually is part of their assessment, and how they interrelate to each other and talk about it intelligently. Whether you're going to use total points, terms, or categories. Which one actually complements how it's assessed at that school or that department? Assignments. What method's going to be used? Going to use letters? Going to use descriptors? Going to use total points? Going to convert to percent? Going to use weighting? What about titles? In this day and age, should we keep running across quiz one, assignment two? I would assume that the teachers actually understand what their assessments are assessing of the curriculum and might be able to communicate them a little more effectively than those headings. Because those headings end up on the individual student report, which goes to parents and students. Category setups. Going to use assessment for and of learning, formative and summative. Going to use strands. Going to use units. Going to use ELOs. Going to use outcomes. Going to use skills. Going to use something different. Clear communication. What will those individual student reports look like? And how does it communicate to parents how to read them? And how is it knowing that everybody, this is how we all do it? Special marks. You know, that's pretty much self-explanatory. Every teacher makes one. Every teacher makes as many as they want, assigns it what they want. So what ones are actually going to be used in, and why? Why have these been chosen? Why is it we use these ones? And how do we support the teachers in remembering all this? Huge amounts of discussions. How is it going to be communicated? Because you know what? As the year goes through, we cycle teachers in and out of our school, and days are kind of gone when, you know, welcome to my school. A couple of weeks, we're going to be having an intern or department support, but don't you worry. Fred will tell you about that when he's not busy doing his. Have a good day. Probably needs to be a little more support than that in this day and age for how we're doing it. Because this is what needs to drive it. But to have that drive it, we need to have that discussion about what are they. And what supports do we need about those ones? When we come to something that's contentious, how do we get that supported? How do we know what they are? What if we need to have someone from the outside come and talk about it so we have that nice buffer? Because we all know how it is. Outsides are always experts. Doesn't matter if you kind of know it, an outside person is always the expert. And gives you that buffer. When they're gone, you go, oh yeah, well, that's what he says, so let's talk about it now. Because this is what happens when it's not discussed, not put in thoughtfully. Or worse yet, which some schools end up going through, gradebook's gone in, they move from SIS to gradebook, Everybody's got it working. And then all of a sudden, principal gets them all together and says, you know, we're going to change everything again. Because that's what teachers love to hear. We're going to change it all again. My wife Linda says, you know, the day may come when you become a principal. Here's a bit of advice. The first day you walk into an elementary school, don't look around and say, you know what's wrong with the school? You're all in the wrong classrooms. You're all changing tomorrow. She says, that would be bad advice. Teachers don't like change. And this whole presentation, in its PowerPoint form, is available in the PowerSchool website. Now, you can find that on the district website, and if you can, I'm impressed. Because it's going through reorganization, and reorganization makes a lot of sense, but it's huge. So, in the meantime, that's how you get to a directory. And you can take any part out of this, you can take the whole thing, you can take and change the language on it, you can change the pictures, you can do whatever you want. That's its purpose to me. And on that website, if you click on training, don't go farther in. If you click on training at the very bottom of the page, because that's where I rate in this world, you will find gradebook planning session. And it has two. It has this one, which is the large one, and it has one for high schools. The high school one takes out everything about letters, takes out everything about descriptors. It's stripped down version that is aimed for Div 4. And it has the D.S. McKenzie parts in Word. Cal says, go ahead, use them however you want. Copy whatever you want. Later this week, it'll also have the two from Emmy Lazert. They're in PDF form, but you can always copy and paste them for it so that you want. Now, many schools don't calculate using the gradebook, and that's okay too. But at least there's ways of recording the assignments and reporting them. And for schools that actually calculate them and want the Emmy Lazert part they've set up for talking about calculating at their school, I actually ran off copies of it. I don't have the larger one just because it's really particular whether it's useful for a school. It's more of a catchment area discussion piece. But I would ask, or urge, or beg, is if your school creates a school assessment philosophy that fits, which is kind of, you know, overall and makes a lot of things, please send it so it can be shared. I would also suggest it would be so valuable if at Division 4, at department head meetings outside of the schools, when you get department heads from different schools together, that gradebook is on that agenda because they all have the same types of courses. And wouldn't it be nice if teachers in Div 3 and 1 and 2 had a chance to talk to people in other schools about how it's actually being used and how it might be implemented and what kind of pitfalls they are finding. And we all know this gets driven by instructional leaders. Just some thoughts.
Anthony,
student assessment still exists, as you can see. It's inside research data knowledge, but it's still there. And so here they are, and their numbers.
Sorry, Anthony, what I wanted to add was just based on your presentation, I think in response to that question, what are our assessment beliefs? I think those conversations will be well framed by HKR as it moves forward in the approval process. That'll be a good anchor for those discussions. And if you weren't aware of the Leadership and Excellence in Assessment Program, that is a fairly rigorous assessment-based program that also can be used for a graduate credit as well. I think there'll be information in the Need to Know news coming up soon, right?
Well, we're shooting for June 1st for the Need to Know, but it all depends.
And this will be our fifth or sixth, I guess, running of that program. And it is a district certification program. But again, a lot of these issues are framed through 30 hours of coursework, an action research project, and a literature review. And if you pursue university credit, an additional assignment. So lots of supports in place, again, to help make sense of this.
That was really good, Anthony. There's another element that you didn't touch on within the district culture that is huge. You did point out those D's that were bumped up to C's, and I'm quite sure what happened there was the principal would have said, we don't report D's, we say D's working at a C level at a lower level of curriculum. So you said it's, the curriculum's always the same, but it's not always the same. Now, when, whatever it was, 12, 13, 14 years ago, when we first saw the HKAR, we were told that we should report grade level of achievement every term and at the end of the year. And then it was optional, then we weren't able to do it. Term 1, 2, 3, we were only able to do it for final mark. And then we were able to do, what was it? Not grade level, achievement level of...
Level of programming.
And this year I see there's another label, and I'm very confused.
It's the programming.
A couple things. I'm glad to hear you're very enthused.
I'm excited.
When I talked about C, notice that I said a grade 9 course. Because it's one of the considerations of the grade 9 course, because as you say, they might not be a grade level, but is that very clearly communicated? Because in this case, they're all in grade 9 courses. The second is that when you talk about level of programming, the level of programming would be at the grade level that the student's actually being at. So what I'll let student assessment explain that.
The level of programming, well, for grades 1 through 9, what had been happening, some schools changed the course banner and actually enrolled a student in grades usually
right.
below,
right.
if that was the situation. On progress reports, other schools chose to write a comment in the comment box. Some schools did both, some schools didn't do either one of those. So communication wasn't clear. When a student would move, or when we would look up a student on District SIS, we would see that they were supposed to be enrolled in grade 6 and were achieving apparently at grade level, but they were asking for an exemption, so we would call. So for district consistency and clarity of communication, we asked for level of programming to be attached to schools currently on PowerSchool. That was our biggest motivator for consistency. It also helped to have those conversations earlier in the year when teachers are feeling, I'm not sure this child, that whatever GLA came with this child, I'm not sure that's where I can start programming. So those conversations are going to be happening earlier and throughout the year. GLA this year is for English Language Arts and Math. The province no longer requires districts to upload any GLA. But districts are still required to clearly communicate, essentially to parents at the end of the year, the GLA in math and language. So I'm not sure that answers.
But we're still able to do it for the other subjects. Is that right?
For this year, schools are still able to decide if they want to continue for the other subjects.
For GLA, you're
right. For GLA.
And when you say for this year, does that mean not next, or does that mean?
We're going to see how the. Again, we're in a transition piece. So we wanted to see how the transition June went, how many schools opted for all the content areas, how many are confident that level of programming for all three terms does the job of what GLA at the end of the year might be doing. So we're in a bit of a transition year, and we thought offering a bit of a choice was better than cutting people off at the...
So what is the label now? A teacher brought it to me just a couple of days ago, and it was something I hadn't seen before, even earlier in the year.
Level of program?
A new label.
I believe it went
LOP.
Because at the beginning of the year, it was PR.
PRG?
And some parents, it didn't connect.
Yeah.
So we decided for space issues, and then we're defining it on the front page now, LOP. Level programming.
Okay.
So now,
but for the final reports, it won't appear as LOP, it'll appear as GLA.
No, LOP is still required for the final term as well.
They're two different fields, though.
Yeah.
Two different fields. So there'll be an LOP and a GLA.
Yes.
And an XYZ.
Can I just ask you a clarification? Because I think in reality that the grade level of achievement has been used for students who are actually being programmed at that grade level, but not performing at that grade level. So in that case, I think that the programming level should not be involved in that, right? Because the kid's been taking Math 9, has 32. So what about around that?
I'm not sure I'm following the question.
Okay, students are receiving less than 50%. in their program of studies. Let's just pretend it's math 9. Let's say their final mark was 42. Well, definitely they have not passed that grade 9 program. But neither are they at grade 8.
Oh, I see.
And I wonder if we mix that up and, you know, the difference about if we had been programming for that child at grade 8, even though they sat at grade 9, I see where that's helpful. I just still think that we're really mixed up in regard to our interpretation of grade level, and that people are just arbitrarily looking back, where was the kid last successful? And my God, they could go from a grade 8 to a grade 5 in the, you know, 10 seconds.
And you know, I can really think those are approached on a case-by-case basis. You know, and I know that I've had these conversations on the phone with people, and they're long conversations, and they typically end up being really good conversations. But as a team, we end up having a lot of those in June where we can't do much about it. But if we're having them toward the first progress report, those conversations with both people walk away feeling, okay, maybe there's a bit of a plan.
Just to give you a little bit more background on the level of programming, they are defaulted to the grade level of the course the student has been placed in, and it can be adjusted if the student is being programmed at a lower or higher level. Okay, so that is reported on the progress report from term 1, term 2, term 3, and you will see, starting right away, what the previous LOPs work throughout the year, okay, so that you can look and see if last time you reported that the child was working at or was programmed for grade 8, but now they're grade 9, you will be able to see that. The grade level of achievement should still be, if they're programmed for grade 9 and just not achieving, their level of programming would be 9 if that's what they're programmed for, but their GLA would be 8. It sounds,
You know, we're confused.
Yeah, and the change, I think Carolyn has sort of gone over why we put that level of programming in. The problem that we had with changing the label, or the issue came up, changing the label on it from, I think it said, I can't remember, it was confusing to parents whether it was the progress or just what it was. So that's why it was changed to LOP. And there is something on the report card that tells what that acronym means.
So we will report LOP for every class?
Yeah, it is defaulted to the student's current grade.
And we're working towards reporting GLA for math and science.
Correct.
Math
and language arts. Right. That's right. So those two core subjects are mandatory that the GLA is reported. Any others are optional. But LOP for every course. LOP is just, it's automatically filled in. It's not, teachers don't have to go in and put it in, right? It is defaulted. Yeah. So you would change it if the child is not being programmed.
I was just checking that it was every subject.
Yeah.
Okay. LOP is just for core subjects.
Oh,
right?
Is it?
Yeah. Just for
core
subjects. Yeah.
Sorry.
Just to change out of controversy entirely, what's a compelling reason to convince an elementary teacher to use gradebook?
I would say there's a few. The first one that comes to my mind is the ability to communicate using interim reports. So they don't need it to calculate it. They can use it to record and let parents know what those assessments are. Because although every teacher in elementary is very, very disciplined and works very hard to make sure the information goes back and forth, sometimes those marks that might have been a little more challenging somehow don't make it. The second would be consistency across the district so that everybody's getting the same communication from one school to another, that parents would look at one school and say, I seem to get a lot more communication from this school compared to this school. The third one would be, as an administrator, if you suddenly God forbid, for any reason, decide to leave for another opportunity or were suddenly sick, and your record of your marks went with you, we have nothing. Because not being kept anywhere that's computerized. Those are a few that I come off the top of my head without thinking hard. I don't think hard. And to wrap up, so it's one thing to see how to change it for those who actually use it for calculating, but all you would do is change that 105 to, all you do is say change that 5 to 100, change the points to percent, probably write it in, and hit save, and converts it. It's also reversible. Change the 100 to 5, change the percent to points, hit save, it locks. The points possible has changed. Student scores exist. You want to leave the scores as is, adjust them based on new points possible, which is really fancy way of saying you want them to adjust the scores back to what they were. Can you say yes? And they all go back to exactly what they were. That's all the process is. Is it as easy as this? No. But again, it becomes a matter of embracing what's actually there if you want to use that method. And the last thing I want to leave you with is realize that what we're dealing with is we're talking about assessment. We're talking about assessment at a high level, making sure we're all on board. Here's what some districts deal with. This is from the Calgary Herald, May 26. Mississippi schools will no longer handcuff students. Public schools in Jackson, Mississippi will no longer handcuff students to poles or other objects and will train staff at its alternative schools on better methods of discipline. Advocates say restraints are often abused, causing injury and sometimes death. Mississippi lawsuits said staffers routinely restrain students for hours for offenses as minor as dress code violations, forcing them to eat lunch, while chained to a stair railing, and to shout for help when they needed to go to the bathroom. So what we deal with is different.
That's not coming here, is it?
And that's all I have. Thank you.